Hello, everybody. Are we sitting comfortably? More or less. Tradition dictates, then I should say, let's begin. So, very pleased to introduce our next speaker. Martina Hoffmann is an artist and sculptor. Her work is very much influenced by her long history of altered states, including her brushes with ayahuasca. And she studied art at the Johann Wolfgang Goethe University in Frankfurt. And she's going to be talking about, what is the title of your talk?
Oh, it's going to be about expanded states of consciousness and art and visionary culture. So I'm really excited to be here with everybody today. And thank you, Deborah, for giving me this opportunity to talk about the things that matter most to me in life. And I'd like to just, I'm not a scientist, I'm an artist. I have been for a long time and probably all of my life. And I would like to approach this subject from a very personal and biographical angle. And I've had many, many expanded states of and altered states of consciousness in my life. Just want to give you a little quick start here. So I was born in Germany, and I have very early recollections of lucid dreaming, especially between the ages of 4 and 6. During that time, I developed a very close relationship to nature, and I recognized the forces and the strength that we can derive from being in nature and how it connects us to the all. At the age of 6, I moved to Africa, to Cameroon, where I grew up as a white minority in Black Africa. That was Africa is an experience in altered states. It brings you into an altered state by state by itself, and once again, powerful nature that I could connect with. And during this time, I had a lot of, I started to develop migraine headaches, quite powerful and repeated throughout the weeks. And during these episodes, I would have visionary and visual and auditory hallucinations. And during one of those experiences, I had my first experience of recognizing a higher force, of my higher self, or maybe God. And I recognized that this voice was truly a guide in my life that I could trust. And it has, this voice has come to me in at my crossroads in life and has helped me to make really powerful decisions. So while in Africa, I grew up with African culture, was very touched by the power and the strength of the African women, their natural way of being mothers, which is quite different from, you know, what has happened in the West. And I was also able to observe the differences between Western culture family and indigenous or expanded families as they occur in third world countries. I was also quite inspired by African art, painting, sculpting. Wherever I walked in town, there were people sitting on the sidewalk making beautiful art. And all of this would inform my art later when I returned to Germany to finish my formal education. At the age of, 12 or 13, I had complete out-of-body experience, which was absolutely spontaneous. I was sitting on the bus to school, and I guess I was just getting into this pre-adolescent stage where you don't know how to deal with your surroundings, and I was disenchanted with school, and I was going through all these natural changes, my body, and I started to play with myself, and I asked myself what would happen if the place I came from didn't exist, and then what would happen if the place I was going to, my school, didn't exist, and then I went as far as going, what would happen if the bus didn't exist, and what would happen if I didn't exist? And at that moment, I just disappeared, and I found myself in the void. Was a terrifying experience, and It took me a while to integrate it, and took me many, many years to really understand what had happened. I went to university in Frankfurt, Johann Wolfgang Goethe University, and here I majored in sculpting, and many of my African influences, inspirations surfaced in my work. I did a lot of mask work, trying to probably uncover my true self by removing masks. Here's some of my early work, A Little Venus. And once again, I became very, I was looking for something specific in my life, and I was trying to find that connection to my work, to spirit, and didn't quite know how to do this. So I gave academics a six-month break, went on a sabbatical, and moved to Paris. And the course of events took me to a beautiful little fishing village on the Mediterranean called Cadaqués. And some of you might know that this is the town where Salvador Dalí lived and worked. And in Cadaqués, I met a wonderful artist by the name of Robert Venosa. And Robert was one of the great masters of visionary art, and inspired by his work, which was absolutely light-filled and spirit-filled, I became a painter. And with Robert, who had been a child of the late 60s, he was kind of a pioneer. He was one of the first ones to take acid in the United States. And Robert kind of, you know, inspired me, turned me on too. And it was quite the life changer. This is one of his angels. And this is a piece he called Yahe Guide, which is his guide. We did many ayahuasca experiences together, and Robert had asked at some point to see his angels and guides, and this is what he could come up with, and he tried to paint it later. He said he never could paint really what he saw, because it's basically impossible to paint this multidimensional space that we encounter on journeys or in altered states, because we just don't have the dimensions at hand to be portraying such an experience and such a reality. So with Robert, I studied the Misch technique, which is a very ancient painting technique. It goes back to the Van Eyck brothers in the mid-1500s, and it's one of the finest painting techniques. I don't want to get too technical here because it would take too long, but it's underpainting in white and glazing, which allows for translucency and great depth of color and form. So my early work, I'm going to go straight to my first painting, which is this one here. This is how I learned the Misch technique. It was rather crude and simple, but it was my first oil painting. I had never painted before. I had been drawing throughout my childhood, so I think I've been an artist all my life. I love to draw and sculpt and do everything I could, you know, I could transform and create with throughout my life. But this was truly my first painting. And after I learned this Misch technique, this was my first portrait I did, very true first portrait. So it's a portrait of Robert. And I wish these colors could be a little brighter. They're kind of dull and dim and dark, but you get the idea. And I had done many portraits throughout my years. This is probably the second portrait I did. And so you see, my work is fairly photorealistic. It's very reality-based. And here's another little self-portrait called Woman Under Glass. So I was really into photorealism and trying to just get a grasp on my technique. But things would change quickly when I encountered a certain substance, courtesy of this fine Swiss gentleman. And Dr. Albert was certainly a great influence on many of us and many visionary artists. And fast forward in my work, this is a piece I would do in 2006. On the occasion of his 100th birthday, I painted this first entheogenic experience that I had in Cadaqués in my early 20s. And it is an image that depicts this instant where I experienced absolute unity and consciousness in all places. And it was an incredible transformational moment in my life that allowed me to accept that there was a higher source the source, I like to say. It doesn't have to be God, and there's many names for it, the source, but I knew, as David pointed out, that there was just a knowing, and once we know, we just do, and there's just no way of explaining it. It has nothing to do with right, left brain existence. It just is, and we know it is. So here's a little beautiful picture when I presented this piece to Albert and his wife, and he was very pleased with it. So I basically went from this piece to doing, having an entheogenic experience, to doing this. So now my work is still fairly photorealistic, but I'm moving into more abstract, more visionary backgrounds. And I've done many, many portraits throughout my life, all trying to depict the energy of a person. As a lot of intuition going into my paintings, I never plan a painting from the start. I rather let it evolve and develop. And I become some sort of a channeler, if you will. I trust that the information that needs to come through for me will come through. I drop into a very deep state of meditation. It happens fairly quickly. And I just paint. And I allow the painting, the canvas, to show me what it wants to be. And I believe when we paint in this way, as artists, we become like the shamans. Since we don't have shamans in the Western world, or not very many left, maybe the visionary artists have, in a way, taken this place, because we work in very similar ways. We open ourselves to spirit and bring in information for ourselves, for our communities, and these informational pieces could be they could be for visioning, they could be for healing, they could be for so many different subjects. And just to show you a few more pieces, always dealing with energy movement, more portraits. He's a gentleman you might know, Ram Dass. I did a portrait in his honor, or for him, and half of the proceeds of the print sales went to his medical bills. And lovely psychedelic couple in California. And here, a portrait of my new partner, Pascal, who's here with us, Merlin. And these are more recent portraits, so you see how my work has progressed and has become throughout the years, and the work with medicine, which I will get back to in a second, more and more visionary. And these are some very recent portraits of three brothers and sisters in Switzerland. So, as most artists, I've have been inspired by the great visionary artists who came before me, and one of them, namely Hieronymus Bosch, with his Garden of Delights. Certainly William Blake, the great visionary on so many levels. I'm very fond of Marty Klarwein, the gentleman who was the quintessential psychedelic artist in the United States in the 60s and 70s, and here's some of his work, Astral Body Alive, Awake. And this piece here, which is called Annunciation, which you might recognize being the cover of the Santana Abraxas cover, for those of you who grew up in that time, and those who love really great authentic rock and roll, here it is. And then there's Vali Myers. She was an incredible visionary from Melbourne, created these incredible opium-inspired pieces. And the great Ernst Fuchs, who was the founder of the School of Viennese Art, the School of Fantastic Realism in Vienna, who created some of the most mind-boggling visionary art, Adams, Awakening and Destruction. And for the dark side, we have H.R. Giger, who is also a dear friend of mine, and who was certainly the creator of the alien monster, And he won an Oscar for that. And you know, the dark side needs to be residing next to the light one in order to create good contrast. And so all of these fantastic visionaries have been inspirations to me. And of course, none of these artists were strangers to altered states of consciousness, nor substance entheogens. And they all had their own preference. In my late 20s, I had a near-death experience, and which basically was the beginning of my true spiritual life. I really discovered my spiritual path at this moment. I searched for a healthier body. I searched for better connection. I searched for ways to ground myself, and I discovered meditation, yoga, became a vegetarian. I went through all the hoops, and but it was a long kind of, well, it was 2 or 3 years journey through the dark night of the soul. And at the end of this experience, I sat down, because I would have altered states, out-of-body experiences, spontaneous, like in broad daylight. I would be talking to you, and I could be starting to see the whole room melt down around me. And it was very disconcerting, because I didn't know how to deal with that, so I became kind of a recluse, painted a lot, but lost my social abilities. So at some point, so I just sat down, and I prayed to the source energy to make it stop. And this sphere literally appeared to me, just the way you sit in front of me. I had this blue, beautiful sphere come towards me, and it spoke to me, and it said, "We understand that this was a very trying time for you, but this was all necessary for you to experience in order to become the person you were supposed to be." And it all stopped in 2 days' time, and I've been quite a sane person ever since. So, I guess that this experience of having this time of having had so many out-of-body experiences, or so many disconcerting moments, really prompted me to wanting to materialize. So I know that the experience of this near-death experience was also a push for me to really decide that I wanted to manifest. Before that, I don't think that I was truly materialized. And at that moment in time, I decided I wanted to do this and be really in my body and live this life. So I began painting these pregnant nudes. And I had lived in Caracas, and at some point I had about 7 girlfriends, all pregnant, and they became my models. And I painted a cycle of birthscapes. And in every painting, if you look closely, there is this energy, lightning strobes, that represent the energy that we are. Even in the most manifest form, we still are only energy at the base of, at the end of the day. And so these are all birthscapes, Mother Earth and her Luna. And in time, I painted these paintings over the course of 7 years. And in time, I formed the goddess triangle, which incorporates ancient female goddess figurines and protector goddesses. And it's a 20 by 10 foot piece, which means a roughly 6 by 3 meters, 6 meters wide, 3 meters high. It's a multimedia piece with sound, and it's my largest piece to date. So during that time, I also did goddess sculpture. I did a series of goddess art in 3 dimensions, and this is my goddess of transformation. And the inspirations for this series were was Paleolithic art, the cave art, Therianthropes, the Venus and goddess figurines of the Paleolithic, and also the women of Africa, their grace and their strength. And this is what I came up with. So this is all work that I created between the late 80s and early 90s. Diana of Ephesus, my interpretation, a more Minoan type sculpture, Arched Angel, Twisted Venus, interesting here, talking about channeling and art and being shamanic and looking for healing energy. The whole body is quite twisted and the spine is very pronounced. When a healer friend came in, he picked her up and he held her in his hands, and being so used to be touching people's vertebrae, he went down her spine and he said, "You put your spinal deformation, I have a tiny little scoliosis in my back, you put it exactly where it sits on your body." It was completely unconscious. Pregnant angel, just a little twinkle. And my Sphinx. And finally, one little piece, resurrection. So the mother archetype, the cosmic mother archetype, has always been also very pronounced in my work, and I've created images of annunciation, always dealing with the energy, always trying to capture that, like what does it look like, because the energy moves, and how do we portray that in a painting? Mother, angel, and child, fairly big. These are all various sizes. These paintings vary in size from, maybe 20 centimeters to 20 inches, so that would be 50 centimeters to 2 meters. This piece is called The One in All, depicting the goddess opening her mantle and embracing all religions within her coat of love. And initiation, about the cycle of life, the DNA that women hold in their reproductive life cycle, and the female and male archetype and the ancestors behind her. So also very important to me is the female spiritual warrior, an entity that I would encounter later on with the mother ayahuasca. And in my earlier depictions, I went through all the religious and Christian contexts and painted my Christa. And she's not dead, she's alive, and the fish are jumping, and she's standing on the spear that is bloody to show her domination over patriarchy, or the suppression of that. This is my fire keeper, which is a female shaman who does not hold the continuation of or ensure the continuation of our life through procreation, but through being the keeper of the mysteries. And this is a little self-portrait of Joan of Arc, which is an archetype that is very close to my own heart as well. And I find that creating art can be very healing, not just for the artist, but also for the viewer. And I've created many healing images. And this is a piece entitled Inward, and it's about the state of meditation. You see self-portrait, you see myself floating above the solar system. And I used to joke and say, this is the place I call home. This is a piece about, I call it the coning. It's a piece about trying to portray that source energy, how big it is, and it's a gigantic energetic egg that tries to be birthed into the earthly space. You see the earth down below, and I just needed to see that visually. And in my late 20s, I went through about a year and a half of holotropic breathwork and regressions. Did it about twice a week, regressions, not holotropic, but regressions. And it was very powerful. I had a lot of memories of other lifetimes, although before that time, I didn't really have an interest in reincarnation at all. And I always kind of, you know, take these experiences and these concepts very open-mindedly, and they could be many things, but I had full-blown experiences of living in Tibet and being a healer, a shaman, and I would go back in time and undo certain things. I learned about time not being linear during these experiences and how you can actually, by changing things in this time here, how you can also heal the past and change everything and restructure the course of your life. And at the end of this 1.5 year journey with transpersonal psychology, I painted this painting. It's called The Phoenix. And one of the traumata I addressed also in this painting was sexual abuse, which I experienced in Africa. And I believe that my migraine headaches were a result of that. And in this painting, I created a little pyramid over the head of the phoenix, which is inscribed with a little something that says, the love you withhold is the pain that you carry. And one more piece of healing energy, trying to survive in a world that is aggressive and filled with destruction. And here, this piece is called the Sueño, El Sueño, and it's just a piece about trying to look into other realities that might bring healing and enter the shamanic realm. The shamanic realm and my work becoming more shamanic happened around the time that my husband Robert, whom I had a wonderful relationship with for 30 years, before he passed away in 2011. And we both met Terence McKenna at Esalen Institute, where we gave regular workshops, painting technique, visionary art. And Terence certainly had a lot to say about heroic doses of 5 grams. And we listened to him well and got back into that. And also, he had many, many things to say about DMT and ayahuasca, as all of you know, I'm sure. So inspired by his wonderful gab of garb, he made us travel down to the Amazon. And here began the journey with ayahuasca. And I've done these journeys. I would go down to the Amazon together with Robert between the early 90s and about 2008, and we would do this once a year and just go work with different kinds of shamans, neo-shamans, traditional shamans. We attended conferences, and it was quite a life changer. Here's, you know, traditional setting of making ayahuasca. If you look at the pot, it doesn't look very appetizing. The brew tastes very bitter. Ayahuasca is a substance that I would say puts you in touch with an energy that is very feminine. And I think a lot of people agree to that who have felt her. There's a lot of images that come to the partaker that are the mother in many guises. She can be like a young indigenous woman. I've seen her as a Madonna. She's a shapeshifter. And after my first experience, I did this piece called The Messenger, and it was really my true first visionary painting. It's a self-portrait of the artist who travels through the veil of consciousness to bring back blueprints from otherworldly realities to manifest them in this year time. And the web became very, very important to me in my work. I began seeing it at night in dim places. I still do, if I really pay attention, and everybody can. It's just a matter of opening your mind. You know, the grid is always around us, the matrix of the universe, Indra's web, you name it. And this piece here is called DNA Spirit. Maybe I got a little inspired by Jeremy painting this painting. And a little piece called La Petite Mort. Little play on words, but still dealing with that energy that surrounds us at all times. So with the medicine, I began creating many images of transformation. And I have to say a little something. Yeah, I'd like to speak a little bit to the usage of ayahuasca. I believe, first of all, it's not for everybody. It's not a must in this time where everybody talks so much about ayahuasca and these entheogens. I think there might be a little bit of a peer pressure and people feel like, oh yes, we have to do this in order to be fully full visionaries. I don't think that's really true. There's many ways of getting into altered states. I've talked to you about my own experiences, and there's certainly meditation and fasting, and you can just do drumming and dancing, and all of these ways are good ways. But ayahuasca is certainly a very powerful and quick way to get into these altered states. And but it needs to be done with proper preparation, with proper diet, with the proper mindset, with the proper set and setting. And if we don't engage with entheogens in this way, I believe that it's not just dangerous, and some of it might not even be dangerous, but I think we just missed the mark. And I think that it's really important to get the most out of it, and getting the most out of an entheogen or a shamanic experience is by being fully present. And if you can prepare yourself properly, then you will have a powerful transformative experience. And for me, these experiences have always been extremely visionary and visual, because I am a very visual person. I've also had experiences with auditory hallucinations, synesthesia. I've seen sound. I've heard smell. And I mean, there's so many ways of, you know, there's incredible variations in this. This gets me a little bit into more popular culture. A lot of my work is being used in festival settings, but I'll get to that a little later. So creating transformation. This piece is called Transformation, and Transmutation is the title of this piece. Here we have the Muse of Conscious Awakening, which was which is actually in the collection of Dr. Albert Hoffman. He loved this piece. I had just painted it in Florence in a workshop, and when we went to see him on the way from Basel, we would go and see him at least once a year, which was always a great day. And he loved this, and I didn't have a title for it, and together we came up with this title. So, you know, a big part of Albert is in that. This is him just not too short before his passing, and at the age of 102, looking at the muse. During ayahuasca, there was a lot of telepathy going on for the, you know, obvious reasons, the chemical constituents, harmonizing, creating incredible communication between people, where you can actually close your eyes and have a close one next to you, and you could be just journeying in the same space. You could be closing your eyes and talking about what you see, and you would be seeing exactly the same thing if you connect with that person, which is great. So beautiful experience, and this happened certainly between Robert and I quite a bit. And this piece is entitled Spirit Wind, just about that beautiful energy that comes when we open ourselves up to that knowing that there is something bigger than us that we can ground ourselves into, as strange as that might sound. And this piece is called Alien Ascension, and it is an attempt to portray something I experienced where I saw myself in hyperspace, and I was an alien, and this is what I looked like, sort of. The Tree of Knowledge, the eyes representing the gradual awakening during the medicine. Sometimes these paintings end up on people's bodies. And so I've had many, many travels to the Amazon regularly with Sylvia Polivoy, for example, in 2003. This is one of my best known pieces called Caught in the Web. It's about the act of surrender. We need to surrender in order to do these powerful medicines. And if we surrender, everything is well, and we can receive the knowledge. And it's about the purge. When we purge with ayahuasca, oftentimes the visions begin. And as Francois, no, it was you, David, has said, we can ask questions. Oh, no, it was Francoise. And this is one of the beautiful things about ayahuasca. You can ask a question, and ayahuasca will show you what you need to know, but in a way that you can understand. So if you're a left-brain person, it might just get really scientific. And if you are a visual person, it might be all images. And it will use, it will explain through your filtering system. It will show you in the way that you can best understand. And it's just brilliant, and it's so intelligent. And plants, I believe, have a great need and want to communicate with us. If you're looking in your front yard and you're looking at what is usually called common herbs or bad herbs, they're all healing herbs. And if we're looking closely, usually what we know need most, let's say dandelions for kidney and other urinary infections or problems or liver problems, if they grow in your yard in abundance, eat them, because the plant is telling you that you need her. And this is true for all plants. So I'm really grateful having learned this from the Mother Spirit, ayahuasca. 2008, this was at Espiritu de Anaconda. We encountered many incredible people. Mitch Schultz was there, who filmed the spirit molecule. Then there was Pablo Amoringo, who is, you know, certainly the famous shaman artist who painted the great ayahuasca iconography. He had incredible knowledge about the space of ayahuasca. Jan Konen, who made the great Blueberry or Renegade movie. And Jan, I'm just going to play a little video for you. I think you're going to enjoy. Jan had created, or has created, probably the best 3D renditions of ayahuasca space. And I picked some fairly harmless spaces, images here, because I didn't want it to be too strong, but you get the idea. Okay. Yeah. So there's a lot of symmetry, a lot of geometrical shapes, a lot of fractals, but it could also be very, very personal, and images from your childhood. You might be hearing voices from people that are no longer, but are talking to you and giving you advice on certain things. And this is particularly beautiful. You hear a little bit of the shaman's whistling, which is part of the singing. And it is true that when the shaman sings, he sings the journey for you, and he can actually modify the journey, the experience for the whole group. Through his voice, he's able to contain the energy of the session. This is Don Guillermo, who we worked with here with the Shakruna plant. This is my rendition of the Shakruna. This is his mother, Doña Maria. There's great respect for elders in indigenous cultures, certainly a subject that is very important to look at in our Western society. Don Ricardo explaining the Shipibo patterns, which Francois talked about, and Dave, and these are songs and gateways, basically roadmaps on how to journey through an ayahuasca session. This is the biggest session I've ever done. This was at Espiritu de Anaconda outside of Iquitos, and we were 70 people. This is before the session, and this is during the session. You see right there in the center, right here, this is Don Guillermo singing to Robert, who had developed cancer in 2003. The doctors gave him 3 months. He said, I'll do nothing allopathic. I won't have surgery. I won't do radiation, and I won't do chemotherapy. He lived for another 8.5 years. And I believe that the ayahuasca sessions were very important in his healing, spiritual as well as physical. It kept his body clean and stable, and it was quite the journey, and this was one of the reasons also why we did ayahuasca regularly in the Amazon, where it is legal under the in the context of indigenous culture and the Santo Daime churches, for example. Dennis McKenna, Don Guillermo, Richard Gossman, all people, Jeremy Narby, we met at that time as well. And very important in the ayahuasca sessions are certainly the visuals. And during these sessions in the Amazon, I would only work on paper. And these are some of the images that that I did during that time. I'm just gonna go a little faster to get to the end of my presentation. And a shaman conference in Iquitos, an interesting concept. It's almost like shop for your shaman. You have all these shamans sit on the stage. I'm not sure if I like it, but certainly you have a lot of choice at these conferences, and you get to pick the person you resonate, the shaman you resonate most with, and then you journey with them. Great, wonderful person. Luis Eduardo Luna, his Wasiwaska, we've worked with him, and more pieces that I did while there in Brazil, in southern Brazil, in Santa Catarina. And this is a very interesting, quick thing. In 2007, Don Juan Acosta came to Boulder to record my brainwaves, and he did a blind study. He blindfolded me and asked me to just close my eyes, and he wanted to see how fast I drop into a deep state. And then he asked me to close my eyes and do the motion of painting and feel into that painting state. Basically, you know, anybody here who's interested in it, I can give you the research after in detail, but what he said is, I reanalyzed your files to be sure of the findings because they are so unique and interesting. And what is so striking about your data is the enormous, robust, in science, increase in frontal delta power during blah, 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 which suggests you go into very deep unconscious territory. So, you know, just to show that, you know, the painter's, the state of painting is just as deep a state of expanded state of consciousness as any other. And I've created many portals and mirrors in my work. A painting can only reflect the viewer's consciousness, nothing else, unless the viewer goes deeper, and then it can be a transpersonal experience. Snakes, very predominant in ayahuasca, have always been a part of my work since I engaged with the medicine. And creating transformative pieces. This is the last portrait I've painted of Robert before his passing. I call it Healing Spirit. Didn't change the course of his destination, but this is Gayatri in honor of the great Hindu mantra. And this is the painting I worked on during Robert's transition, the last year of his life, called Curandera. And I painted this to support his journey. The portal has a lot of images here. Conferences. Getting into culture, visionary culture, there's a lot of events throughout the world, and I believe that there's an increase in the need in Western culture for us to become tribal again, because we've lost connection with nature, but we also lost connection with each other. And especially in youth culture, there's certainly literature, in youth culture, there is a great need for this connection, and there's Burning Man and so many festivals where people get into alternative architecture, connection to the earth, ecology, social support, conscious alliance, feeding the poor, you know, discussing important matters in settings that are not scientific anymore. This is all important to us, and I've been a big part of that. Painting live, sharing the creative process with people in live settings, and just gonna weave through these. I've painted, you know, in front of tens of thousands of people in rock concerts, and which is a really amazing experience. And workshops, you know, these young kids who come to the festivals, they really want to, they come, they do substance, many of them do, and then there's this need to express. So we did this workshop at Boom Festival, 450 people showed up. And this is a recent workshop I did in Colorado. There's many exhibitions, Giga Museum, Burning Man. I mean, these things just pop up. University of New York, the very recent Sonic Bloom, which is, these are exhibitions that are held in tents, and tens of thousands of people come and see this art. And you don't see it in museums, you only see it in these festivals and in these special exhibitions. This is a very recent one, Shimmeria, and in this, in these new exhibitions, there's also indigenous artists coming in, and these young guys are coming out from Peru to show us work that is really ayahuasca work, and they start living in Europe at times. This is Luis Tamani, one of the better ones, one of the greater painters. They create beautiful works inspired by ayahuasca, but also mixed with, you know, the a different way of rendering the image, more photorealistically, as in Western art. So I'm just going to go through this, more art. Yes, I'm going, running really over time. Naya Museum, let's see if I can just fast forward. Without the psychedelic elders, we would be not talking here at this conference. Stan Groff, Dr. Ralph Metzner, Dr. Albert Hoffman, Terence McKenna, and so this is just a little clip that I did for, I picked for you of Roberts because of his healing journey with ayahuasca, and I think you're going to enjoy. And this is almost the end of the presentation, not too much of a, so. Here we go.
You evolve and mature highly.
But through that creation, we inspire other people to think of the universe.
I mean, the artist is the great creator of everything you see around you was first a vision. You know, speaking about visionary artists, you look at everything, that was first a vision, the chair, the microphone, somebody designed that, your car, you know, and then it was made into an actuality, but based on somebody's vision. There's nothing that you see around you, except for nature, that wasn't created by a visionary. And ultimately,
even that,
you're surrounded by visionary art. That's where you are. You know, the great cultures are all formed by visionaries.
What's your feeling about the future? How does visionary art affect the future? And you as a visionary,
it creates the future.
Right.
Yeah. That's the answer there.
Thank you.
You know, I mean, when I paint, I transcend time. I transcend time and space when I paint. It's the deepest state of meditation. You know, the creative act, you know, it's the secret to create. I would tell everybody, throw out your television sets out the window and sit down and write a poem, draw a picture. Then you're connecting to the universal energetic source. That's what's so
good. Well, that universe exists out there, and you know that. And you also realize that there's continuity in the universe. That's a big plus, is know that there is continuity. And that, you know, takes away the fear of death.
About 3 years
before
his passing.
Which is a major problem on this planet, which creates much of the turmoil that we experience, the fear of death. And ayahuasca makes you die a little bit, but it makes you understand that this is part of the process and it's okay.
I have faith that we can continue on. I don't believe reincarnation. I think we keep going.
Going.
Mm-hmm. And yeah. Expanding. Mm-hmm. And for this, I feel very good.
Okay, so you've seen most of my work, and these are my very recent pieces that I've created over the last year. I'll be closing with that. I know I've been way over time. So Stag Queen, the guardians, my guardian angels are snakes. and Stag Queen, which is at Naya Museum, one of the great visionary art museums in France, and the only one to date which shows visionary culture in art. Expansion, the muse of the underground Medusa, Colibri, the Beja Flor, another totem animal of ayahuasca, aligning to the realm in the midst of heaviness and darkness. The only choice we have sometimes is align to it, and it makes it all easier. The arrival, hoping for divine intervention, shapeshifter, and finally my universal mother, which I painted in honor of my beloved mom who passed away last year. So I've lost in 7 years all my closest, and my art has been a savior and a healer for me and a great support. And ayahuasca.